It was dark. Every day for me was dark and heavy. That part of my life, I almost can't stand to remember it. I'm not the kind of woman you'd want to befriend. I bet the entire town of Magdala was afraid of me. Clearly, I wasn't in my right mind. You asked me what life was like for me back then. The only way I can really think to describe it is captivity. No, I wasn't physically locked up in a prison or caged like an animal at market, though I'm sure many hoped I would be. But make no mistake, I was enslaved, imprisoned by sin, and the loneliness was suffocating. Have you ever been there? Facing every morning with unrelenting hopelessness. But then, I met someone they called Jesus of Nazareth. I wasn't looking for him. I am not the same since he found me. He changed me. He drove away my tormentors. And I was finally free in the truest sense of the word. I'd never known compassion like that before. From that moment on, I wanted nothing more than to be one of the many who learned from him. So when he invited me to follow him, I barely paused before saying yes. Of course, I didn't know exactly how I would help. I mean, what do you offer one who feeds thousands with measly fish and tiny loaves of bread? So I did whatever I was able to do. I helped with cleaning, provided financially when I was able, whatever our band of followers required. We walked with him from Galilee all the way to Jerusalem. But as we went, he healed broken people. And he taught about Yahweh, our God and Father. Oh, the stories I could tell you if we had the time. Surely, this was our long-awaited Messiah. By the time we arrived at Jerusalem, I was convinced beyond a doubt that Jesus was the anointed, prophesied one. And it seems all of Jerusalem was with me. Oh, the welcome they gave him there. I wish you could have seen it. Oh, the palm branches waving. Shouts of Hosanna! Hosanna! It was beautiful. So you can imagine how I could hardly accept it when just a few days later, the way the Roman soldiers whipped him, I don't know how he survived it. Seeing my Savior on that cross, oh, it's a memory I wish I could erase. A nightmare without end. I don't have the words to explain, but please understand, no one else could have endured what he did. His life was not taken on that cross. It was given. And then he was dead. My source of new life was dead. How was this possible? Hadn't he come to free us? I watched as Joseph and Nicodemus wrapped him in cloth and placed his body in the tomb. And as they did so, my hopes were buried with him. Because the one who had released me was now imprisoned under pounds and pounds of burial linen. But I had to walk away. Because the Sabbath was coming. I got up early on Sunday and headed back to the tomb. Along with a few other women, I brought ointments and spices to honor the body of our Savior. And as we walked, I replayed in my mind the events of the last few days. I hadn't actually accepted that Jesus was dead. But if he was, what did that mean for us who followed? For me? Was it all pointless? And then the most horrifying thought occurred to me. If Jesus is gone, will I fall back into the darkness he found me in? Was my trust in him entirely empty? What happened next? Oh, I still don't quite understand it. I'm still trying to figure this out here. But I was even afraid to go tell the other disciples what I saw. I mean, who would believe that news coming from someone like me? But still, at the tomb, that cold, seemingly hopeless prison, there was an earthquake. And angels, and a stone door rolled away. And deflated burial cloths. He was gone. At first, I thought someone had stolen his body. But Jesus answered that question well. He was alive. He met with me and many others in the days to follow. And eventually, I understood. Jesus died and freed us from an oppressor much fiercer than the Roman government. But when he rose, he proved the only thing empty about my faith in him is the tomb he borrowed. Hallelujah! He is risen!
I'm just going to keep it. Oh, there. Whoa. Hello. Good morning. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. My name is Sarah Leonard, and it is my joy to serve as your liturgist this morning. I'd like to welcome you to St. James. Welcome back. If we haven't seen you in a while, welcome home. And then also, if this is your first time visiting with us, a special welcome to you. Okay. Usually in a church service, we would say, put away your phones, silence your phones. Today, we're going to try something different. On the back of your bulletin is a QR code, that funny collection of dots and squares. If you will take a picture of that, open the camera on your phone, it will take you to the St. James website, and you can check in if you're a member. If you're a visitor, you can. There's a place to enter that information, too. That's how we're staying connected. So, Christ is risen into the 21st century. Amen? Okay, St. James is headed into the 21st century. And keep that open on your phone because we're going to use it a couple of times during the service. I will confess that my phone is down on the front row in my purse. I'm not sure it's silenced. So if something starts ringing, don't look around. You'll just see me run and try to fix that. We are so happy that you're here. I don't know if you heard it in that song, and I don't know if it's because there's been too much March Madness played at my house, but that hymn, that old hymn, has some trash talk, has some taunting, because the words say, death, where is your sting? Right? Amen. So Jesus overcame the grave, and then whoever wrote that hymn decided they were going to taunt the grave. So let's taunt the grave this week, but before we do that, let's greet each other. Please don't taunt. Please be nice to each other, but take a minute and greet those around you. As you are able, please remain standing. So this may be the hardest thing I do today, which is get your attention again. Stop all the friendly chatter, please. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, no, please, keep greeting. But if you are able, please remain standing and join me as we say our affirmation of faith together. This is our chance to say out loud to each other and certainly to God that we agree on these things and we believe these together. So if you'll join me, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Standing and join us.
Christ is for these announcements.
They've got a worship song to lead us in. If kids of any age, even if you don't know it, you're welcome to come to the stage.
So sometimes we have an announcement video, and when that happens, you can depend on the details. When it's me, you probably need to double check this in your bulletin, but I'm going to try. First, I want to tell you that we're having our red carpet event. It is a prom-like event for our friends with special needs. You have a couple of assignments here. First, reach out to anyone you know that might be interested in joining us as a guest. Second, if you're interested in volunteering for that event, please sign up. And as we move forward, we'll have donation requests. Again, this is where that magical QR code comes in. All of that information is there. Red Carpet Affair is April 27th. Next, VBS registration is open. We just got through spring break, but we are already thinking and planning for summer. It is June 10th through 14th. Again, same kind of thing. If you have kids who are 3 years old and potty trained to fifth grade, completing fifth grade, please sign up and have them join us. We also can use volunteers for that. And finally, there is a concert from a group called We Are Messengers coming up on April 6th. Kim, who did a monologue earlier, is coordinating that, so please reach out to the church office if you're interested in attending that. Did anybody else notice there's a whole bunch of little people behind me? Is it just my imagination, or are there people back there? Okay, I'm going to let those people take it away.
Right, I'm going to invite everybody to stand with our kids and sing.
Thank you.
other kids who'd like to come forward for a little kids moment and a little bit of fun to hear God's word, you are more than welcome. Kids of all ages, if you want to, but welcome again this morning. Great job, everyone. Can we give a round of applause? Great job, choir. Thanks for coming, buddy. All right, there you go. Nice job. All right, so if you all want to take a look over here, I'm just glad to be able to be here with you on Easter morning. You know what we say? He is risen. Can you guys say it with me? He is risen indeed. Let's try it one more time, kids. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Leighton, you already have a question? What is it? Seventeen eggs this morning. Whoa, good job, Leighton. Well, you know what? Leighton, you're always the guy that helps me to kind of segue into the next points here. I wanted to talk a little bit. How many of you all did Easter egg hunting this season here? Pretty fun? Yeah. All right, so here's a quick question for you. Good little joke for you. I'm borrowing from my son, Joe. How many Easter eggs does it take to fill an empty Easter basket?
A lot.
A lot, good. You in the back there. 2,000. Yeah, more. Yeah, maybe. 60, zero to fill an empty Easter basket. Oh, how about you, Connor? 30, 36. All right, ready for the answer? It takes one egg to fill an empty basket because it's no longer empty. There you go. Thank you, Joe. I know you're walking at home. That was pretty good. I'm done. No, just kidding. All right. So one of the things about Easter is we have here in the church a story about Jesus, right? For you who've been in the church here, if you're coming to visit, the Easter story is all about Jesus. He died on the cross on Friday and he rose from the grave. And I know for you as kids, that's a lot of stuff to think on. And so we have some things in the world around Easter that I think can help us to understand what Easter is for us a little bit more. Now, I don't understand how we got into a bunny dropping and laying eggs. Like, that is just more of a miracle, almost. I won't say it that. But what I want to talk about is Easter eggs. Y'all hunted for Easter eggs, right? Did any of you do coloring of Easter eggs? Yeah. Look, you're going to do it a little bit here. I want to use Easter egg coloring to talk a little bit about what the story of Easter can mean for us. So we see up here I've got a few little things of dye. For those on camera, I will get behind it. So I've got a few different colors here. I've got, well, kids, what color is this one?
Yellow.
What's this? What's that? Yep. Red, pink, something like that. I don't know. Good job. You know your colors. All right. So what do we do? Can you walk me through Easter eggs? I've got a couple eggs here. What do we do with the eggs? How do we dye the eggs? Yeah, you over there in the green, but yeah. You have to put them in the dye. So what color do you want me to put these in? Okay, I'm just going to choose one. We'll do some green, and then the red. You want the red. Okay, that's good color. So we put them in the dye. We let them sit for just a little while, right? So what I want to talk about is dye. Hey, not yet. Dyeing eggs is a lot of fun, but when we think about this in terms of what Jesus did for us, it's a reminder of all that Easter can be about. Like these eggs, Jesus, after he died, he was put into a grave, a tomb, and he was laid to rest, right? So we had to lay some eggs to rest. So I'm going to take another egg and lay it to rest. How about in the blue one? Does that sound good? Okay, good. All right. So we got three of the eggs in there so far. So who can remember how many days did Jesus stay in the tomb? Yes. 3 days in the tomb, right? He was put in the tomb on Friday, and he came out on Sunday. That's 3 days that he was in there. And so all that time that he was in the grave, like this egg, he was also doing work for us. And so what Easter does for us is when we, like Jesus, rise from the grave, we're a little bit different, aren't we? And that's what Easter eggs are, too. I'm going to let these sit for a little bit longer, but the first step that we have when we think about what Jesus can do for us is we have to confess our sins, accept Jesus to be the Lord and Savior. Who was the one who rose from the grave for us? All of you can say it out loud. Who rose from the grave for us? Jesus. So who defeated death for us? Who can forgive us of our sins when we do something wrong? Jesus. All this is about Jesus for us here. But the next step that we have in our faith journey is what we call baptism. And it's represented here by going down in the water and then coming out clean. How many of you like to take baths? Half. Okay. How many of you do it because your parents tell you you really need to? Yeah. Sometimes we've got to listen to other people, right? What do you look like after you come out of a bath? Are you clean? Clean from everything that's dirty? Okay, that's kind of what baptism represents for us also. We're down in the water, and we come out clean, just like these Easter eggs. And so I'm going to pull out one of the eggs. We'll say this green one here. And hopefully, for the sake of my object lesson, it's already colored a little bit. What do you know? Thank you. I've actually got a... How's it looking? A little bit green? All right. I'm going to keep it away from you kids so you don't get it all over your pretty Easter outfits. All right. Let's try this red one here. And it turned out pink. What do you think? Yeah? Good? Okay. So now, are they the same color that they were when they went in? No. They're a little bit different, right? And so that's what we have at Easter, that with Jesus Christ, he takes all the old dirty things that we had. He's the means to clean them up for us. And then when we accept him on Easter especially, we rise up as new people, clean and able to do something completely different. And so Easter is all about renewal, about change, right? How many of you have seen a lot of the caterpillars around recently? Yeah, have you seen those? What does a caterpillar become? A butterfly. It transforms into something else. So we were once something before Jesus, and now we're something after once Jesus cleans us up here. In the scriptures, in Bible, it says in 2 Corinthians 5, I want you to listen to these words because they're words for you. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, who's anyone? Everyone. Does that include you? Yeah, all of this is for you as well. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. How's that sound? All right. We're getting near the end of the school year. You're going to be going into a new school year. You're going to be going to a new thing. Easter is all about you becoming a new creation in Christ. So the old order of things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So just like all of these Easter eggs, the blue one turned out pretty good, right? Yeah, something different there. And this yellow one as well. Actually, it did pretty good. Nice. It's pretty yellow, isn't it? We'll see how it goes the rest of the service. Stan, good luck with the team. All right. So the next time you all have Easter eggs or dyeing some Easter eggs, what will it remind you about? God. And what does Jesus do for us? Everything. Changes us from something old into something new. And that's kind of what Easter eggs are all about. They may not be in the scripture, but they encapsulate the whole gospel story. How many of you all learned something today? Yeah, okay, well done, okay. 1 second, can I have a little prayer with you guys before we go on? And then I'm going to invite some of my youth to help. We've got some gifts for you. One of our youth members, Raina, made up some little bracelets for her, and her sister Nia helped out. And so if I can get a couple help, when you guys go down to the chairs, you can take some. How about one take some on here, and if you want to go over on that side. Just hand them to the kids as they go. Can I offer a little prayer for you all? Y'all did so good. Parents did not do awesome. All right. Yeah, Cadence, 1 sec. When they come down, we can hand them to them, but let me pray with you. Can we pray real quick? Yeah, let's pray. Dear Holy Lord Jesus, thank you so much for what Easter means to all of us who are your children. And as we look at all the different symbols, we know there's candy and everything else here, but we have what you have done for us. An empty cross where you died for our sins is the only means to forgive us. An empty tomb that you've given us new life. And so like the coloring on Easter eggs, we become something new in you. So we pray, dear Lord, your blessing on these children here. We see every moment of the day they grow into something new. So bless them as they become leaders for you in this world, to share your good news with those who near it. We thank you in your name. Amen. Amen. All right, you guys can grab one of the bracelets on the way down. Thank you so much again.
Okay, they are a hard act to follow, but I can do this. So another use of that QR code is to connect with the church with prayer requests and praise reports. Those don't just end up in an empty void. They are actually prayed over by members of our prayer team. And using this QR code, it strikes me that there is a lot that messes up our lives. Let me say it this way. Technology messes up our lives in a lot of ways, right? But our God can use anything for his good, and he can use technology for his good. So please use that QR code to share any prayer requests or praise reports with the church. We would like to pray for you. But now we're going to pray together, and in our order of worship, this is usually called Prayers of the People. I'm the person with the mic saying it out loud, but I am trusting that you are praying where you are, because that's what makes it prayers of all of us, prayers of the people. So if you'll bow with me. Heavenly Father, as you instructed us in Scripture, we approach your throne of grace with confidence. We come before you as an imperfect people, in need of your forgiveness for our sins. We thank you and praise you for overcoming sin and death so that we might be able to live in the goodness of your kingdom on earth and one day be raised to eternal life. Because you rose from the dead on the third day, you defeated death and proved that there is nothing you cannot overcome. Help us to realize that we are never stuck or trapped by our mistakes because you're always ready to give us a new start and make us a new creation. Deliver us from fear and let us seek faithfully the ways you would have us be your presence to our friends and our neighbors and our own families. Help us dwell in your presence one moment at a time and to know that you are ceaselessly at work in our lives around the world to bring your reign of peace. Your word tells us that you heal the brokenhearted and bind up their wounds. Lord, I ask your healing to those among us today who faced heartbreak this week. Show us how, as a church family, to be your hands and feet to those who are hurting. Heavenly Father, help us to live each day as a resurrection people, confident that we follow a living Savior and that the power and presence of the Holy Spirit is with us and within us. May our hope be a beacon of light in this dark world. Thank you for the chance to be together this morning and worship you. As we say together the prayer you taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to read our scripture passage today. If you have the Bible app on your phones, again, there's that phone. We can use technology for good. You're welcome to join in reading. It's Ephesians 1, 17 through 23, and Paul is writing to the church at Ephesus. Paul is saying, I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you this spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. That's us. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. You should be reading along so you can see when I trip up. That's one of the reasons to do that. But thankfully, the scripture is the scripture, the word of God for the people of God.
Awesome job. Good morning again. Happy Easter. He is risen. If you leave with anything in your mind, that is what we hope for today. This is the power of what we have in Jesus Christ as we are celebrating Easter this morning. And it is represented in all of these things: great music, great worship, great kids doing great things, and a great crowd of God's people gathered in worship of the only one who could do something like this for us. Amen. So welcome to this day here. I want to, again, just invite you, if you want to, on your phone, the YouVersion app is what we use here. Coach, there's any games going on yet for March Madness now, right? Yep. Yeah, okay. I'll get you done before the first game. Yes, we go there. So, but again, we're wanting to use all we can to help you to be able to connect your life, your real life, with the real love of God. And so you can do that as you follow along here. And as we get ready for life after Easter, that's been on my heart a lot for us as we gather today. It is so good seeing so many of you here at church. Those of you who are able to make it on Christmas and Easter, you are blessed. We are blessed to be here as well. And so always what's on my heart is, okay, what's going to carry us forward into this week here? And so one is these what we can through the scriptures here. I do want to let you know, for the church family and for all the families in the church, we have a new family and children's ministry director that we just hired. Yes. So we will get a chance to meet her and her family next week. It is Storm Bass and her husband Devin. They've got a little daughter, Carden. We were blessed with two really good candidates at the end, but she is going to be phenomenal to carry our family ministries, to serve you and your children and growing in their own faith, and as the family to grow up together. Kids, so here's your assignment for next week. We're going to have family worship because it's a communion Sunday. For the kids moment, I thought it'd be fun if you just wanted to come up with some questions to get to know Storm better. And the crazier the better, because we need to put her on the spot. She was here. Storm, you're not here now, are you? She was here at the sunrise service, already here. So, okay, we're good. Okay, just kidding. But I also want to just hold that up for us as the church. We're going to kind of end in this place here where God is calling us beyond Sunday mornings. For your life and for mine, Sunday morning for 1 hour is a very significant time, is it not? But it is a very small amount of our time in our faith life. And what God is desiring for us to experience in Easter is new life to be lived all the time. And so as we gather this morning on Easter, we're coming to the end of a series we've been in, going through Lent, of considering the different stories around the Easter morning experience. Those who experienced Jesus at the cross and then suddenly see Jesus either in the empty tomb or in his resurrected form. We actually started the series with Mary, whose story you heard. And all of them had stories where it was kind of, they were oriented in life in one way. And then the crucifixion disoriented, disrupted everything that they were about, so that in the resurrection, God could point them to the new life. If you heard in Mary's story, as she shared here, one of the things that we know for scriptures is that Mary had 7 demons that were driven out of her by Jesus. And so you have to wonder, when she came to the empty tomb, are all these demons going to come back? Because the one who drove them away is no longer here. And the power of the resurrection says, no, because I defeated death, Mary, all of your demons are dead and gone. They are dead indeed, and because he is risen indeed, amen? And so as I gather us this day, I've been pondering what it's like for us when we consider again the light of Easter. We've come out of the Christmas season. Some of you who were here with us on Christmas Eve, that was only a few months ago. these years when Easter is early, they're just, wow, crazy how quickly it goes. But it's because I think God wants us to experience all the gospel all the time in a really short way. At Christmas, we proclaim and we declare that those who are in darkness have seen a great light. And the light, that is Jesus, has come into the world, and the darkness cannot overcome it. How many of you remember that from Christmas? Celebrated every day. That is all fulfilled here on Easter. One of the ways, as I've been preparing, and even this morning had a chance to kind of reflect on the different images that we have for this, is at the sunrise service, as we were driving in, it was super foggy in the midst of being dark still. So kudos to everybody who came out for that service and helped out for it indeed. And there was one of our folks who's a longtime member of the church, probably knows his way to the campus, forward, backwards, and everywhere in between, but because of the fog, got lost on the way to church. But he found his way here. I was all good. God is good. Thank God for GPS and everything else like that. But I want us to kind of use that for our own sake, that life often puts us in a fog. Even if we're following the best path we can, the GPS that we might have sometimes leads us in the wrong way, or life throws something at us that knocks us down and feels at some places like it just kills us. We get lost in that darkness. We get lost in those places of hurt and anguish and even death. And today we celebrate that Jesus Christ, the risen Lord, he is risen. We'll wake us up a little bit more here. He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. That light overcomes everything that this world could throw at us and more. And so as we gather in this scripture here today, written by the Apostle Paul, I want us to bow in prayer and let these words sink into us, to let Easter resurrection and the power of the resurrection to be deep within your soul, for you to live your life here into eternity. Let's pray. Dear Holy Lord Jesus, you who are the Word that was made flesh at Christmas, you know the lives we walk. And Lord Jesus, it is because of this broken world and it is because of our brokenness that we sent you to the cross. But dear Lord Jesus, because your love was so great for us, you went to the cross for us. You forgave us of everything that we could by our faith in you to do so. And Lord, so we give up that faith and surrender it this day to let the resurrection power be what restores us, renews us, and gives us new life, that we can be that light in this world. So Lord Jesus, speak to us again through your word. May all the meditations on our hearts, especially those ones where we feel like we are in a tomb, may they be holy and acceptable unto you, Lord Jesus. For you are our rock, the one constant in the midst of everything throughout eternity that is always swirling, but you who are our Redeemer to restore and renew in everything that we have. In your holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Happy Easter. The light has shined at Christmas. It shines through the death of the cross and gives us new life in every moment of Easter. That is what we gathered here today. And as we heard in this letter from the Ephesians, from Paul written to this church in Ephesus, they were a young church that was just starting out. They were, in a sense, like a lot of the disciples and like us as well, experiencing something new, but still in the fog of a Roman Empire that was seeking to destroy everyone, of even the Jewish leaders who were seeking to put them down, even their own lives of what is going on now, Lord, you're doing something. But a letter written for them and for us to know this is the power that we have in Jesus Christ because of his resurrection. And I'm landing on that word power as we are coming to Easter this weekend. There's a lot of different descripting words in the text of the scriptures that describe what Easter is about, but one of the most frequent ones is this word power, because it is powerful, isn't it, what God has done, that God has taken what was dead and brought it to new life. That is what Jesus offers for all of us. And so I want us to hold on to this power. And Paul starts this letter with how deeply God desires for us to know this. Do you hear these words again as they were written for us here? I pray that you would have a spirit of revelation and of wisdom, that your heart would be open to hear these words, that they would be revealed to you in new ways. So, and so today, whether through kids' songs, through great music that is here, for even these words, that God would reveal himself and his power to you today. And the wisdom to know this is much more than just words on a page, things to remember, ways to do life well. This is wisdom of God, the only means for you to find salvation from your sins and your brokenness, and new life when you feel like you've gone through hell. This is what Easter is all about. And so Paul goes on to say, I pray that the eyes of your heart would be enlightened. Man, I love that poetic language. You who've gotten to know me as coming from an engineering background, I love figuring everything out, but sometimes we need language like this to speak to us, that our heart can see things, right? For those of you who are married, it is your heart that has seen your spouse and said, you know what, that is the one for me. For those of us who are parents, it is the heart that we see with our kids. This is what God is inviting for you and for me. It is that your heart be enlightened to these things, that it is deep within you, that of all that God has to provide for you. And so we see briefly here in the scriptures a few things that I think for us to hold on to Easter of 2024, of the new life that God gives us and the power that we have in that life. He proclaims first that it is power of hope. Right, he uses this phrase that you would know the hope to which you have been called, and how powerful hope can be, can it? Right, it is hope that carries us on when we are in dark places. And today I want you to put your hope in the right thing, in the right place, in the right person of Jesus Christ. That hope that we have, that because he went through the death of the cross, but even more so had power enough to raise from the dead, that whatever you might be going through, with your hope in Jesus, he will see you through. Now, yes, it may not mean that everything may work out to be all shiny glory, but what it does mean is that the God of the universe, who has the power to save everything and anything, is there for you. So I pray you would hold on to that hope, that it would enlighten your heart in those dark times. And to help us and call us away from all the other places we sometimes put our hope in this world. Putting our hope in the companies that we're working for, or hope in other things like that, or for some of us like me, a recovering perfectionist people pleaser of all the good things I can do. They'll always fall short, won't they? Yeah, even for me. Yeah, I know, I'm such a great guy. But because what God wants us to know is... the hope that he wants to give us is a hope of resurrection power that will carry us through whatever we're going through, even when we don't have it within ourselves, and especially when we don't have it within ourselves. It is a hope that we have that can be the means of our salvation in Jesus Christ and him alone. And Jesus did not go through everything on the cross, and the power of the resurrection of an empty tomb on Easter morning for us to be able to feel like if I'm just a good enough person, I'm going to get into heaven. There is nothing we can do to get ourselves into heaven. Nothing that we can be good enough at that will get us there. What we have within us, the brokenness, it comes from the very start of creation, and it goes on. How many of you all did not sin this morning? Just kidding. It is there. And Jesus Christ is the only means to get it. And so today, if this is the day, you need to confess. Lord, I've been trying on my own. And how many of you, if you've been trying and trying, you start losing hope in yourself? Let your hope reside in Jesus Christ and the power of his resurrection to heal you from all of that brokenness and that sin. Let his blood that was shed on the cross do the work for you to wash you clean. Let his power of resurrection bring you to new life. Amen? That is hope that you can hope in when everything else would fail around you. That the power of the resurrection gives us hope because what seems to be going on in the world right now is not the final word. A broken marriage is not the final word. A child who is diagnosed with a disease is not the final word. A job that you've lost that you loved is not the final word. Amen? By the power of Jesus Christ and his resurrection is that there is always the new thing that God is going to be doing for you and with you and through you. Amen? This is Easter, and this is the power that we have here. Because we have this hope, we have been given these great gifts of God. Paul goes on to write about these riches of his glorious inheritance to the saints. I love the fact that our God is a gift-giving God. Amen? Do y'all ever think about that much? That God loves you so much, he wants to give you things. Sometimes we need the kids to help us to remember that. They love getting gifts. How many of us adults need to remember that? You know what? God, I need something from you, and God is more than ready to give it to you. Amen? I'm calling for a lot of amens today, so be it. Yeah. But what this scripture is saying for us is an inheritance we have from Jesus. Now, Dad, I'm going to put you on the spot. My dad is here in the audience with us, living a new life down in the villages. He worked as an estate probate attorney and everything. So where do inheritance come from? The people who died, right? I got that from you at least, right? Someone has to die for us to get an inheritance. Jesus died on the cross for us to rise again so we could receive all the gifts of heaven for our lives here and now. Amen? We have a glorious inheritance of an eternity with God in paradise. Oh, man, I can't wait to get there. But it is something for us right here and now. It is new life right now. It is new riches of life right now. And God's riches look a little bit differently than the world's ones. It is not all about fame and glory and money and all those other great things, although he may bless us with those. But the riches that God provides for us are the deeper things that we need to gift us. We need love, don't we? Glorious inheritance of rich love from God. How many of us are seeking peace today? In the midst of a world that's at war, in an election year that's coming up, peace beyond this world is what we get out of the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. How many of us are desiring joy in our lives? Not just the nice things that happen, but the deeper place where, you know what, life has been tough the past few years. God, I need some joy. That is resurrected joy that you get from Jesus Christ, from heaven on high to your earth like now. How many of us need gentleness, kindness, faithfulness, self-control? All of these things are the riches that God gives to us. In the scriptures, they're called the fruits of God's Spirit, that when Jesus Christ rose from the dead, he made all of these gifts available to us by the indwelling of his Holy Spirit within us. We've got that coming in Pentecost, but it's right here and now. Yeah, all of this is wrapped up here today, that it is through the power of his Holy Spirit that when we lack joy, God gives us the joy we had never had. When we are needing to love somebody that, it is tough to love, God gives us that love that we need. All of these riches that God gives for us are made available to us right now through the power of his resurrection. Amen? So that our lives can go and live the resurrection for those around us. Paul finishes with these terms for us here. In his incomparably great power for us who believe, the power that he used to raise Jesus Christ from the dead is a power that is given to us who believe. How many of you all feeling the power this morning? Amen. All right, some of us are. We might need some coffee to get it here. But what I want you to hold on to and the riches of all that God gives you is the resurrected power available in your life right now. The power of the resurrection to pull you out of whatever you might be going through is in you now to go and give to others around you. How many of you driving here today have a family member, have a neighbor, have a friend who is going through a really, really hard time and needs some new life? By the power of God's resurrection in you, you have the means to be able to go and give that to them as well. How many of you have been through something so bad, but because you have gone through it with Jesus, you have a new story to tell? That story is powerful. It's a story I don't have. It's only a story you have. And the power of Jesus Christ being so personal for you and for I is that God transformed your story, and God can use that story to help somebody else. I want to offer for us and for you all who are here this next season that we're going to be going through in the church calendar and the sermon series that we're in is leading up to Pentecost. That is when Jesus Christ, after being around for 50 days, hanging out with everybody in his resurrected form, had the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And we're going to look at that right now for what it means to our lives. Most importantly, about how our lives can be our lives of faith can be shared with other people. That's a tough thing for us. That takes the work of God sometimes for us to be able to share our faith with others, especially in this day and age that might be not only just a way that is, you know, trying to convince them, certainly not a way that wants to condemn them, More than all that, it's a faith that becomes contagious to them. Right? I know contagious has a little bit of some little scare to it after the pandemic, but those things we catch that we love, that is what God has given to us to give. And so this next season, we're going to be learning what it is for us to learn how we can be contagious with our faith by what God has done in our lives. And so I want to show a short promo of a Bible study that we're offering, and we're inviting everyone to be a part of. We're going to do it Sunday mornings. My sermons are essentially going to be the study, and then we'll have some small group time. We'll offer some other small groups as well. And then opportunities for us to be able to go out into the world and to do something, whew, probably really transformative for us, of going out and sharing our faith with other people, but transforming this community for those who need the power of the resurrection for us here. If we have the video queued up, it's about a minute and a half. I want to just grasp what this next season is going to be about. I'm super excited for what it can mean, for what we can do to make the power of the resurrection real for us. So if you can queue up the video for us here.
The contagious faith is one you just can't keep to yourself. You have to share it. It's infectious. It's going to spread to other people. My hope is that as the message of contagious faith gets to church members and whole congregations, that they'll all realize they have a part to play in spreading the good news of Christ, but they can do it in ways that fit them. Every one of us has a natural contagious faith style, and we want to help them discover it. I think these five contagious faith styles, the friendship building style, the selfless serving style, the story sharing style, the reason giving style, and the truth telling style, really flow naturally out of the pages of the Bible. When we open the pages of Scripture, we see that they didn't all share their faith the same way. And we see biblical examples of all of these. We also see Jesus doing these. And what we do is just take those principles and apply them into our lives and say, how can we follow those models to reach the people in our world today?
Well, I'm super excited for what that can mean for your faith and what it can mean for us as the people of faith together. And so you can go on Amazon this week. The book is there for like $10 or $11, and we'll be going through that for the next 6 weeks here. If you are a guest here for us today, come on back and let us be a part of your life as well. We are on Easter, and we are Easter people. Amen. God has given us a story that transformed our lives. How many of you can say, you know what, there is a person in my life who drew me into this faith? For some of us, it might have been our parents bringing us to church, but maybe it was that Sunday school teacher who said, you know what, there is something deeper for me to hold on to. Maybe it was a good friend. Well, you know what, in the power of the resurrection, you can be that person for others. So come on back next week and for these next 6 weeks for us to learn and train, be able to be God's people, to go out and share this in the world. For that, my friends, is what God is calling us out of Easter to do. A lot of us have brunches to go to this afternoon, got a lot of family that we're going to be hanging out with, but I pray that today, this Easter experience will be real for you, to know the power of God's love for you that gives you hope in a world that so often has no hope. That you can know the riches of God's gracious gifts given to you through Jesus Christ. First, by his death on the cross, to save you from your sins, to wipe you clean, but to save you to a new life in the power of resurrection. Salvation is both and for us here, from all the bad to all the good. But I pray that you would go about your day to share this good news with those people around you you know who desperately need to hear it. That resurrection becomes real for them as it's become real for you today. So let me offer a word of prayer. And in that prayer, if this needs to be a day you want to accept Jesus Christ and follow him, you can lift up that prayer as well and find me or others afterwards to start that journey together. And then we will close with a call to offering in our final song. But let us pray. Your holy and gracious Lord Jesus, we thank you, we praise you for all that you are and all that you do for us. Lord, you have done what we cannot. We know and confess we can never be good enough. We confess even here today we've got sins we're still working through. You have paid for all of those on the cross. You have washed us clean with your blood. It is done. It is finished. That is that word from the cross. But Lord, we've got something just beginning. For you have risen. You have risen indeed, and that means our lives are risen to new things. So, Lord, may we find our hope in you. May we open ourselves to receive the gifts that you have desiring to give to us. And, Lord, may we go forth as your people of power in this world. The church is not just about us. It is about you and your power needing to be real in the places where people are hurting, where they're broken, where they're lost from the path you have for them to go upon, where they can receive new life, redemption, and new hope in you. So, Lord, fill us again by this. Bless this study, by this that we will be taking on together. Bless us to be your people, to go forth and make Easter real for everyone around us. And all God's faithful people say, amen and amen. God bless y'all. Happy Easter.
We have a few more things to do. I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward when they're ready. When my children, who are now in college, were growing up in our children's ministry, when they got to offering time in the children's service, they would hoot and holler and cheer. And so I've tried to bring that over here into big church. So I'm going to ask you a question. Do you know what time it is?
Yeah. It's offering time.
And are we excited about that? Yes, I thought we were. So if the ushers would come forward,
that's probably
one more chance for you to use that technology and the QR code. You can give on the St. James app. You can give on the website. You can give in the baskets that are going to be passed. If you're watching online and you would like to give, you can mail a check to the church or also give online. Here's what's important. It's an act of worship when we give back to God. And this is our chance to do it. Just like we sing, just like we pray, our gifts are important to God. And then, as a church body, we use those gifts, combine them all together, and we reach out into our community. It's a great design. But the design works when we all play our part. So I'm going to ask you to join me in prayer and ask God's blessing on this offering. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the blessings you have given us. Each one of us and all of us as a church family. As we come before you today, show us new ways to offer our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service. We offer back to you a portion of what you've given us, and we ask that you bless those around us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much to all the team who have helped to put all this together. You who are in the back and running around behind the scenes, all the singers, thank you so much for doing that. Good job. Thank you for being the choir who sings along and now the choir who sings out into this world. It is Easter. It is a new day. The old has passed away. The new has come. Amen? Amen. May you live in that for Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and went to the grave. He is risen. He is risen indeed. You have a powerful message within you, a powerful word to give to those around you, a powerful life to live, no matter what you've got going on now, that God has called you to live and live for others as well. So I pray, come on back next week. If this is your first time here in a while, it's good to see you. We hope to see you. We've got many, many things throughout the ministry of the church to do. Kids, remember to come up with some fun questions for Miss Storm. We've got a new day in the children's ministry as well. Oh, you do. Okay. Y'all can stick around a little bit. They're going to be playing some Handel's Messiah as we go out, right? Yeah, but we'll be having cookies and coffee in the back there as well. Love to be able to connect with you and connect your real life to the real love of God. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And wherever you might be in life, maybe it is that place where you're feeling like you're in hell. May you find peace in your heart that passes all understanding, knowing how much you are loved by God so much that he went to the cross for you, and more importantly, he rose from the grave for you as well to give you a new life to live, filled with the power of his love. So go in your life from your north and your south and your east and to your west, sharing that love, that powerful love that can lift other people out of their hells and find new life in God themselves. And all God's Easter glorious people say, amen and amen. God bless you. Happy Easter.